right, we're going to get started here this evening. Good to see everybody back. And grab those hymn books and stand with us. Turn to hymn number 45. Hymn number 45. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Hymn number 45. Grab you a hymn book. Hymn number 45. All hail the power of Jesus' name. And let's sing it out tonight. Here we go, all four verses. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown. Start 121. At the cross, where I first saw the light. Sing it out. Here we go. Alas, did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that same such a worm as I? At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. I heard somebody do that echo rolled away there in the chorus. I like that. And so if you can get it in there, fit it in. Shout it, sing it, say it, whatever you want to do. Don't spray it. But fit that one in there, and that'll be awesome. Let's sing it out now on the second verse. Was it for crimes that I have done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. Was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. How many of you did it? All right, I got four of us. Nice job. Let's all do it on these last two verses. All right, here we go, verse number three. Well, mind the sun in darkness hide, and shut his glories in. When Christ the mighty Maker died, for man the creature sin. At the cross saw the light, and the burden, here we go now, rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Well done. Well done on the rolled away. 596, victory in Jesus. 596, victory in Jesus. When Brother Harold was out here, and he and his family, they added some extra words in here, bought and sold on that chorus. I just can't remember where they did it. So if you can remember, throw them in there and help me remember. All right, a little bit extra here on this one tonight. But let's enjoy it. If you can't remember, just stick them in there anywhere, okay? I know it was on the chorus, though. Here we go on the first verse. I heard an old story how a Savior came. Awesome. Glory. How he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me, found, and he bought me, sold his redeeming blood. Remembered it right there. So he sought me, and we shout found. He bought me, sold. All right, I thought that was pretty good, pretty cool when they were singing it. And so let's throw those in there, and then with his redeeming blood, don't forget to praise God. I like it. Here we go on the second verse. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me, found, and he bought me, sold with his redeeming blood. Praise God, he loved me and I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story, and some sweet day the song of victory. Sing it out.
Paul has put a California twist on victory in Jesus, so we're going to pray about that one, because anybody coming from California changing the hymns is it's wicked, brother. And I'm good friends with Brother AJ, but I'm going to have to talk to him about bringing the California hymns in. And look at Miss Jessica up in the front row tonight doing her thing. Man, it's like serious revival. I ain't seen your face in years. And the boys, they're like, you know, we're here too, Pastor. I know. You're doing good. Good. Let's go. Is that Ari back there? She's back there preaching. It's a glory done taught her how to preach. I bet you Miss Gloria would be a good preacher. Ask Jesse. She's a good preacher, isn't she? Yeah, praise the Lord. All right, good to see everybody tonight. Let's pray. Let's ask the Lord to bless the service. I felt like God met with us this morning. Ask him to meet with us again tonight. And the Holy Ghost is meeting with Ari. We know that. And so that's a good thing. That's a wonderful thing. And so let's pray. Let's ask God to have his hand on the service tonight. And I'm thankful that we're all here, and AC's working pretty good, and I like that. And that's a blessing, because it seems a little wet, a little hot out, and so. But thank God it's not snowing. I don't know what else to say to that, but that's good. I think I kind of like the snow a little bit better, amen, the cool weather. But I'm not going to complain about it, because it's summertime. It's good, amen. And so let's enjoy it. Let's pray pray and ask God to bless the service tonight. Father, we love you, Lord. We thank you for your love for us. Thank you for allowing us to be here tonight. Lord, thank you for all that you've done in our life. And God, I do ask you and request your presence to be heavy upon us tonight in this service. Through every song that's sung, God, may you be lifted up. May we recognize you and make you at home here. May this be a place that you don't have to stand on the outside, knock like the church in Revelation, Lord, the Laodicean church. And may you feel welcomed here by our spirits, by our thoughts, by everything about us, Lord. May it be a place where the Holy Spirit can come in and do a work. Lord, we need that tonight. I pray that you bless every aspect of the service in a mighty way. Lord, help us to reach this city for Jesus Christ. Help us to be folks that are spiritual folks, that are growing folks. Help us to always be on the upward plane, looking to increase in our wisdom and in our stature for you, Lord. And help us to honor you with all that we do tonight. May you be high and lifted up in this service, God. We need you. Bless those that are sick. Help these that need help tonight, and that'd be all of us. Lord, may you get the victory, and may you be preeminent in our life. We love you tonight. We need you. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. Thank you for standing. Great choir. Thank you.
sits God Almighty as a judge upon his throne. Holiness is all around him as he judges sin and wrong. Satan is the old accuser as he stands before the king with his list of accusations. All my sins he tries to bring as he points accusing fingers to where I stand before the throne. Then a voice behind me whispers, "Child, I'm here, you're not alone."
That's my Savior, my interceder, and he's standing in my place. As he stands before the Father, he speaks one word.
All right. Well, been a while since I heard that one. I like that one. I remember driving down the road in Hot Springs, Arkansas, hearing that song for the very first time. And I want to say it's the Victorious Valley Girls that sang that song. Man, we really need to resurrect one of them old Victorious Valley Girls CDs. Anybody ever get any of those from us years ago? Man, they are God's hand was on that. There's a girls' home down in South Carolina, maybe, and they were saved out of like off the street, just orphan kind of girls, and man, they got them singing for the Lord, and God's touch was on them, and this lady named Susan McGill, and God was on her and her husband, and some things happened between her husband and different things, but man, Susan McGill, if you can ever look her up on YouTube Music, maybe Susan McGill will be on there, maybe I don't even know if the Victorious Valley Girls will be on there, but it's good music. And they have a whole CD on grace, and I like that. I mean, a whole CD, just 12 or 15 songs on grace. And Miss, I don't know what I was preaching about, Miss Tania, but I was telling those kids in West Virginia, you sent me your playlist a while back, and I forgot what it was. And I said, man, me and Dale, we all enjoyed that playlist. There's a couple things we weren't really understanding. But that's just the way it is sometimes. But it was a good playlist. Music's very important. And I don't remember what I was talking about, Dale. Do you remember? But anyways, I have no idea why I brought it up to those young people. But music's so important that if you don't get good music and you continue to listen to wrong music, there's a lot of teenagers. I don't know about our church. A lot of teenagers are caught up in bad music. And Mom, Dad, I'm just telling you, man, them headphones, it's good to look on those things to see what they got on there and to put securities and different things on there because you want them. You say, I don't want to force them. Well, you better force them. The devil's going to force them if you don't. And so it's good music will change a life, and it will disciple you in a way to help you in a great way. And so I'm thankful for good music. And so I believe we're good. Everybody's here already. And so everybody's been here before. Remember, junior camp, we're going to adjust the time. We're going to now leave at 1 o'clock because they can't check in till 2. And so go ahead and feed them lunch and all that stuff. We'll have dinner for them tomorrow night, and that'll be good. And so hopefully that doesn't mess anybody's plans up, if work or something, and we can work around you. Just talk to us if we need to do something earlier or whatever. We can help out with that however you need, and that'll be good. And then let me also, invite you, if you wanted to go over there at night and roast some marshmallows with them, text Brother Paul, Brother JR, Miss Kara, Miss Lisa Algren, and that's always an opportunity to go over there and laugh with the kids and roast some marshmallows. And so if you don't like roasting marshmallows, that's a problem. Amen. Something's wrong. Amen. You like roasting marshmallows, Manny? Oh yeah. No, I like mine burnt. I like to put mine in the fire, let that thing burn for a few minutes and then blow it out, and then just like, ow. I mean, just pull it off the stick and it just melt in your mouth. We need marshmallows right now. Amen. That would be a blessing. I can taste the marshmallow. And so, you want me at home? Never mind, I'm busy. No, I'm kidding. No. We're gonna roast some marshmallows sometime, Kara. I would love that. That would be a blessing. Date night, marshmallow roasting. We bought a fire, date night and family night put together. Right? Yeah, that. So we'll get that. And hey, we'll just have church activity over there. Let's just start roasting marshmallows together. All right, let's do this. Miss Lisa's birthday was Friday. And then Miss Christina, your girl's birthday's like right now? Okay, you guys come. All three of y'all come. We're going to say happy birthday to you guys. And that's a blessing. Do we miss anybody else's birthday? Mikey, your birthday? It looked like Mikey was going... that's not what you're saying? Okay. And so, good. And we love all of them. All right, let's get the ages. How old are you going to be? 10, and how old did you turn? Whoa, so you're both 9 right now? Very, very good. That's awesome. Both, do you like that part? Like, I'm the same age as her right now? Yeah, I thought so. And Miss Lisa's just a little more than that. That's okay. I remember when we were in Bible college, I graduated. I went back that next year to preach Bible college and told everybody I was going. They already knew I was going to Philly. And I preached, and I preached, he doesn't need you, but he wants you. And then Brother J.R. came up. He's talking to me. He goes, I'm moving to Philly. We're going to be there to do it. We're going to help you. I'll just get a job, do whatever we got to do. And then Lisa was sitting on the front row back there talking to everybody. And I go, did you tell her? And he goes, oh, yeah, no, she's fine with it. She loves it. So, and I'm telling you, they never missed a beat, man. Came here from the beginning and got married. They came here in you got married in 09 too, right? Yep, got married in 09, came and helped start the church. So I appreciate Miss Lisa Algren. Many of you don't know it, but Miss Lisa really holds this whole thing together administratively and supplies-wise and thinking wise, and she's made like 2 mistakes in 13 years, and then the two I can't even remember. I think one of them was lemonade. Like, where's lemonade? Oh, I forgot it. And then what a great testimony. I'm just saying, I've made a lot. I've made 60,000 mistakes with this place in 13 years, and I was like, yeah, you have. And so, well, happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, and let's sing happy birthday. You ready? I said a lot about Miss Lisa, didn't I? No, good. All right, good. All right, let's sing, bro. Let's screw up so everybody can see you. And Miss Lisa, get up here too so everybody can see you. Everybody wants to see you. All right, shoot up a little bit further. A little bit further. Just right over here. All right, a little bit. There you go. All right, here we go.
Happy birthday to you.
Woo!
Happy birthday to you.
Woo!
Happy birthday. God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
All right, happy birthday, girls. Guys, take some candy, and Pastor's a loser. I need to start coming with money in my pocket. Just reach in there. Just dig down in there. See what's under there. Yeah, you know, the M&Ms are kind of, at this point, kind of boring. But there's a lot of them on there. All right, there you go. Yeah, just go ahead. Get what you want. Just keep going. That's good. All right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just take your time on this. We're good. Nobody's watching. Nobody's waiting. We're good. Okay, Miss Lisa just used those girls. Give me this. Give me this when I'm out. Oh, you see, didn't use you? Okay, good. All right. All right. You good? You feeling good about it? That one's empty. Whoa, wait a minute. Oh, my. Okay, go ahead. Just take your time. What are you looking for exactly? Oh, a Hershey. Okay. Yeah, just go ahead. When you're ready, when you're done, that's fine. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, yeah. This is good. This is awesome. Those are empty. I don't know who put those empty ones. You got it? You good? All right, feeling pretty good. All right, good. Oh, Brother Paul. You're Brother Paul's favorite out of all your sisters and brothers, he said. Miss Christina, who's that sitting next to you? Oh, it's Willie. You're starting to look more like Willie every day, man. The glasses are back. You take them glasses off, he's like a movie star or something, man. He just, who was he? All right, praise the Lord. All right, so here's the rest of the announcements. Next Thursday, no, the following Thursday is the 28th, and the Solid Rock, we have the Northeast Vision Summit. I know that this takes some work, and we'll have, you know, Brother JR and Brother Paul will work and figure out how we can do it. But we'd like to get everybody and go over there that Thursday night. That does hinder some folks, maybe. Maybe if you got to work late, maybe you could, you know, text somebody and say, save me a seat next to you. We can work all that out. But we do like going over there on Thursdays. I think we did that last year. Some years we've stayed here. Some years we've took the whole church. But I do feel like it's the right thing to do this year. We'll go over there. And if Northeast Summit is just a bunch of churches from all over the Northeast, but now it's becoming an American thing, coming and then hearing preaching. And I know that Brother Gibbs has not been healthy. I think he's kind of sick. I don't know if he's going to be coming this year or not, but I hope Brother Kenny is, and then some other preachers that normally come in, and that'll be good. And then you just pray for, if you could pray for us, you know, we'll be there during a daytime thing. It's really good for my soul. It's good for our families to hear the preaching and different things to get in with those preachers, especially Pastor Clark, who is a wealth of wisdom, Pastor Clark is. And so pray about that. We'll get you a time when the bus, vans, whatever we do. We got three vans now if we count Bible Baptist's van. So we got three vans. We can drive folks. We'll make sure everybody has a way to get there. We just have to make a certain time to get here by, to get over there so we can get in there and get some seats because they go quick. All right, if you have any questions, please let me know. That'd be a blessing. We'd really like for you to be there if you can. And it's a great service, and it's all it's very uplifting. To be a, Thursday nights are always the best part of the service because you got the choir, you got everything happening, and it's just a good finale for the Northeast. And we live in the Northeast, we're trying to reach the Northeast. So pray about that if you can. All right, Brother Paul, come on, let's we'll sing and we'll shake some hands.
All right, grab your hymn book. 396, do Lord, oh do Lord, oh do remember me. 396. This is one we like to clap to. Some rhythm, and if you don't, clap anyway. It'll be good. 396, there's just two verses. We'll sing them both and then shake some hands. Here we go. On the first verse, I've got a home in glory land that outshines the sun. I've got a home in glory land that outshines the sun. I've got a home in glory land. Shines the sun way beyond the blue. Do Lord, oh do Lord, oh do remember me. Do Lord, oh do Lord, oh do remember me. Do Lord, oh do Lord, oh do remember me. Way beyond the blue. I took Jesus as my Savior, you take him too. I took Jesus as my Savior, you take him too. I took Jesus as my Savior, you take him too, while he's calling you. Do Lord, I can't hear you, oh do remember. down, shake some hands. We'll come back and sing in a minute. Brother Jace, pray.
Dear Jesus, help us that we have a great day. Hope that we get a lot of money.
Yes.
And hope that the church stays safe in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. All right, let's take our Bibles tonight and turn to Genesis chapter number 37. Genesis chapter number 37 in the Word of God. Amen. I'm going to switch over. I think I need to turn this one on real quick. Genesis chapter number 37. Put that right there. Let's see here. And we're going to begin reading in verse number 1. The Bible says, "And Jacob dwelt in the land wherein his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. These are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age. And he made him a coat of many colors. And when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. And Joseph dreamed a dream, and he told it to his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. And he said unto them, Hear, I pray you, this dream which I have dreamed. For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field. And lo, my sheaf arose and also stood upright. And behold, your sheaves stood round about and made obeisance to my sheaf. And his brethren said unto him, Shalt thou indeed reign over us, or shalt thou indeed have dominion over us? And they hated him yet the more for his dreams and for his words. And he dreamed yet another dream and told it to his brethren and said, Behold, I've dreamed a dream more. And behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars made obeisance to me. And he told it to his father and to his brethren, and his father rebuked him and said unto him, What is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Shall I and thy mother and thy brethren indeed come to bow down ourselves to thee and to the earth? And his brethren envied him, but his father observed the saying. And his brethren went to feed their flocks and father's flock in Shechem. And Israel said unto Joseph, Do not thy brethren feed the flock in Shechem. Come, and I will send thee unto them. And he said unto them, Here am I. And he said to him, Go, I pray thee, see whether it be well with thy brethren and well with the flocks, and bring me word again. So he sent him out of the vale of Hebron, and he came to Shechem. And a certain man found him, and behold, he was wandering in the field. And the man asked him, saying, What seekest thou? And he said, I seek my brethren. Tell me, I pray thee, where they feed their flocks. And the man said, They are departed hence, for I heard them say, Let us go to Dothan. And Joseph went after his brethren and found them in Dothan. And when they saw him afar off, even before he came near unto them, they conspired against him to slay him. And they said one to another, Behold, the dreamer cometh. This dreamer cometh. Come now, therefore, and let us slay him, and cast him into some pit, and we will say, Some evil beast hath devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams. And Reuben heard it, and delivered him out of their hands, and said, Let us not kill him. And Reuben said unto them, Shed no blood, but cast him into this pit, into the wilderness. Cast him into this pit that is in the wilderness, and lay no hand upon him, that he might rid him out of their hands to deliver him to his father again. And it came to pass, when Joseph was come unto his brethren, that they stripped Joseph out of his coat of many colors that was on him. And they took him and cast him into the pit, and the pit was empty, and there was no water in it. And they sat down to eat bread, and they lifted up their eyes and looked, and behold, a company of Ishmaelites came from Gilead, with their camels bearing spices and balm and myrrh, going to carry it down to Egypt. And Judah said unto his brethren, What profit is it if we slay our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites, and let us and let not our hand be upon him. For he is our brother and our own flesh, and our flesh and his brethren were content. Then there passed by Midianites, merchantmen, and they drew and lifted up Joseph out of the pit and sold Joseph to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver, and they brought Joseph again into Egypt. And Reuben returned unto the pit, and behold, Joseph was not in the pit, and he rent his clothes. And he returned unto his brethren and said, the child is not, and I, whither shall I go? And they took Joseph's coat and killed a kid of the goats and dipped the coat in the blood. And they sent the coat of many colors, and they brought it to their father and said, This have we found. Know now whether it be be thy son's coat or no. And he knew it and said, it is my son's coat. An evil beast hath devoured him. Joseph is without doubt rent into pieces. And Jacob rent his clothes and put sackcloth upon his loins and mourned for his son many days. And all his sons and his daughters rose up to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted and said, for I will go down into the grave unto my son mourning. Thus his father wept for him, and the Midianites sold him into Egypt unto Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh's, and the captain of the guard. Let's pray, and then I'll give you the title here in just a few minutes. Let's pray. We'll have a song. Father, we love you so much. Thank you for the word. Thank you for allowing us to read it, especially after this morning, hearing about it. And then no doubt there'd be folks in here maybe that needed to read that passage of scripture. And then there were some that came up to me afterwards and said they were currently reading it. And that's a blessing. But God, I love the Bible. I love how it works. I love how it speaks to us and love how it spoke to me and helped me. And so, Lord, I pray this message will be a blessing to your people, to myself, and to help us. And to help us to see what we need to see and to do what we need to do, Father, I pray for a mighty work upon our life tonight, Lord. Use the word and change our life, I pray in Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. Thank you for standing.
There is no greater song. There is no greater faith. Testifies, the angels stand in awe to hear the saints declaring the greatness of our God. Let every hallelujah, let every glad refrain invite the King of heaven to come and take his place. Proclaiming the great things he has done. Let God be crowned with glory with every hallelujah.
There is no higher king, there is no higher throne, majestic and eternal, his kingdom stands alone.
Proclaiming the great things he has done. Let God be crowned with glory with every hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Take his place. face, with every voice proclaiming the great things he has done. Let God be crowned with glory, with every hallelujah.
Amen. Praise the Lord. I know you probably remember me saying this before. When I got saved and I went to teen camp that year, God touched me at teen camp, and I started reading my Bible on the way home, read it for 10 or 12 hours. You know, as the years gone by, sometimes I tell people the story of, like, I read it for 38 hours straight. But it was a long bus ride from South Texas, San Antonio, to El Dorado, Arkansas. It was long and hot, amen. But read that Bible, and I remember getting to this part and reading about Joseph. I'd never heard of Joseph. Never one time in my life have ever heard of his story. And I began to read it, and I thought, that is unbelievable. And I remember standing up on that bus, and Brother Paul remembers that he was in the back of the bus with the teenagers. And I looked back there, and I stood up on this bus going down the road, and I said, Brother Paul. And he looks at me. I said, you ever hear of this guy named Joseph? And Paul's like, Burton, Joseph was the man. And I've never forgotten that. I can still see Brother Paul saying that. And he is the man. It's an unbelievable passage. And, you know, I was reading the scripture this morning, and I felt like the Lord was saying we could go preach on Joseph quite a bit. And I've thought about that through the years. I did preach on Joseph a few times years and years ago. It's a great passage of scripture. And so I want you to notice just a couple of things in this very quickly. The Bible says in verse number 3, it says, now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children. Now Israel, his name is Jacob. Remember, we talked about this. God reached a man named Abraham. He gave him the covenant. He says, Abraham, I'm going to use you. I'm going to multiply your seed as the sand, which is by the seashore. Genesis chapter number 12. And I'm going to use you in a great way. I'm going to curse them that curse you and bless them that bless you. And you're going to be a blessing of all the nations. It's just the way it is. And we're part of that blessing, of Abraham's blessing and the Abrahamic covenant. Covenant, which never ended. This is what's awesome about it. There are some people that would try to get us to believe that God hates Israel and the church has replaced Israel, but the Abrahamic covenant was a never-ending covenant. The Davidic covenant was an ever, what is it? It's Davidic, right? Whatever, Davidic. The Davidic covenant. That sounds better. David's covenant was a never-ending covenant. Now, Moses gave some stuff that was if you do this, I'll do this. The covenant Moses gave was something that kind of came to an end. But Abraham's covenant never did. And so it's a blessing to know. And so Abraham has a son named Isaac in his old age, 100 years old. His wife was 90. It wasn't supposed to happen. They messed up a few things and tried to have it their own way and had Ishmael and kind of messed things up. We know that. Abraham has Isaac, and Isaac has Jacob. Jacob wrestles with God one night about the will of God, and the Lord names him Israel. But I forgot what Israel means, a father of many nations. I think that, what is it? Prince of nations? Yeah, prince of many nations or something like that. And so Israel is now, he's got several sons. He's got 11 or 12 sons at this point, 11 sons. And we see that some of them were dishonest workers. Because Joseph would go and he would see what they were doing, and he would report back to his dad. He said, "Dad, they're not working. They're doing evil."
As a matter of fact, as I was reading tonight, it said that Joseph went to where they were supposed to be and they couldn't find him. He's wandering in the field and they said, man, your brothers aren't here. They're in Dothan. Which I'm going to look at this and never thought about it, but Paul, but I bet you they weren't supposed to be in Dothan. I bet you they moved and they were supposed to be where they're supposed to be, and now they're going to bring in a more evil report to their dad, and they kind of got mad at Joseph and they didn't like Joseph. And so this is where we're at in the passage of scripture. And the Bible says, now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many colors. Now it's important that we think about this tonight, because I want to preach on the controversial coat. And what I mean by that is this. This coat is symbolic for all of us. It really is. When God's love looks down on us, and when he saved us, he gave us, and we'll look at some scripture in just a few minutes, a robe of righteousness. He made us special in his eyes. We're not better than anybody, but we are saved by grace, and God loves us a whole bunch, and we're special in his eyes. And so Joseph's dad gives him this coat of many colors, verse 4. And when his brethren saw that the father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him. Now you said, well, they had a right to hate him. No, you never have a right to hate anybody. Hate is always wrong. And so they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. And so there's a lot here that resembles what we said today, Joseph being a type of Christ and coming to this world, and his brothers hated him there and the world hated him while he was here. And listen, a lot of people are against it. If you've not watched lately, there's a lot of stuff being said about the church now. Especially when all this stuff happened with the Supreme Court, all this transgender stuff. I mean, that stuff's creeped into our junior church. You know, homophobic things and homosexuals and people, young kids that are believing all this junk. And listen, and so what's happening now in the news is they're throwing a lot of rocks at us for what we believe. And they can believe it's right, but we can't believe it's wrong. And we're allowed to believe that. And so Joseph has got the coat of many colors. His dad loves him. And he dreams some dreams, and the brothers don't like the dreams, and they decide, well, we're going to get them. So when Joseph shows up, they see him come up far, and they go ahead and get him. They put him in the pit. They sell him to the Ishmaelites, and the Midianites pull him out of there, and they get 20 pieces of silver. Remember, they sold Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. And so he's a type of Christ. And so he does that. But look, tonight I want to paint Joseph as a type of us who has a father that loves us, and a father that loves us so much he's given us a coat to wear for him. A coat that's going to make some people angry. A coat that's not going to be popular. A coat that's going to make some folks say, you know, I don't agree with that. And what we do with our coat is very important. And what Joseph did teaches us some lessons on how we are to live with our coats. See, Joseph could have been tempted to conform to his brothers. He could have been tempted to conform to that crowd that did not believe like he believed. My dad loves me. I love my dad. My dad wants me to do right. I'm going to tell my dad when they don't do right. See, listen to me, teenagers. There's nothing wrong with someone who wants to do right. Matter of fact, if you criticize that, you are messed up. The person that wants to do right ought to be able to say, I want to do right. And we need to teach our kids that, man. We don't take a second seat because we don't want to be right and tell people the right thing to do. And so Joseph was tempted to conform, I bet. I mean, really, Brother Paul, all his brothers hated him. They wouldn't speak peaceably to him. It wasn't like a really good situation for Joseph. Now, I'm just going to be honest with you. We don't face a lot of opposition, most of us in this room, including myself. And I'm telling you, as the days grow on, the possibility of that is very strong that we will, whether we, but if we don't live for the Lord and we conform to them, you know, there's a lot of, by now, this has been a couple years now, by now there's a lot of so-called Bible believers that are preaching it's okay to have abortions certain times. We was at teen camp, and I wasn't there for the session, but one of the young girls started talking. They were talking to the preachers, and they was having a little back and forth, and I guess it was fine. And she said, well, you know, it's not fair that they take that right away from the woman. What if she gets raped? Now, listen, I don't agree with anybody being raped. I don't agree with incest. But I'll tell you, quite frankly, that baby didn't do anything. And the Bible says children are a heritage of the Lord. And then the baby still has, God put that baby in that womb in a bad situation. And that baby could still be a blessing. And listen, all these people have been killed. And so this girl's saying this stuff, and I'm thinking, man. And she supposedly got saved 4 years ago. And so Christians are, Raphael Warnock, he's supposed to be a pastor. He's a senator in Georgia. Black pastor, pastors of the church, Martin Luther King pastor, supposedly. He's all for abortion and all that stuff. But, you know, that's opposite of what God's word says we are to be. And because he lives inside of me, Manny, I'm against it. Hey, you and God's word don't have to tell me that. I know it's wrong. And so there's a temptation to conform when you have the coat. Because everybody else is doing something, and you might want to fit in with them because you don't really want to listen to them say, why do you always have to tell? Why do you always have to do right? For years, and my kids growing up, and Brother Paul, I'm sure we've all dealt with this. Our kids have come to us with problems with other teenagers or other little kids when they were little kids, and this is just the way it is for every parent in here. And they would be wanting to, like, you know, daddy, what, they know I want to do right, they don't want to do right, and we're trying to teach them not to conform to it. And then I'll say, well, I'll handle it. And my kids, without a doubt, say, even at little ages, daddy, no, please don't say nothing. And I said, well, why not? I'll take care of it for you, I'll help you. I shout, no, dad, please. They won't like me. They'll treat me bad, dad. They'll talk about me. And that was going on at early ages. And listen, what's wrong with the coat God gave us to live by? The God says, look, when we see wrong, we point it out, especially in our Christian schools, in our churches. Man, we don't want sin in this place, open sin. If everybody knew something that was tragically wrong with one of our sisters and brothers in this church and you didn't speak up to help them, shame on you. It's always right to do right. And so Joseph might have been tempted to conform. He might have been tempted to conceal it. You know, I know dad wants me to wear it. When dad's around, I'll put it on. But as soon as dad leaves the room, I'm going to take it off. I'm going to go fit in with everybody else. Hey, listen, God didn't give us that coat to conceal it. It's okay. Hey, why would I need to conceal something that's good? And why would I need to not be able to be proud of something that's good and proud in a good way? We were at the gym, and I may have said this already. This guy had, he was walking on a treadmill, and he had a shirt that said Bibles and Biceps. And I thought, man, that's awesome. Sir, where'd you get that shirt? He goes, I got it on Amazon. I went right to the phone. Boom, got it delivered. Bibles and Biceps. I thought, man, I ain't got much of biceps, but I like the Bible thing. And me and Kara was at Aldi's the other day, and we was walking out the door, and this older black man was standing there, and he kind of just jumped in my way, and he's looking at me. And where I live at, man, everybody, nobody's got a chip on their shoulder, man. They're just friendly folks. And he looks at me, he goes, I love that shirt. And I said, oh, yeah, man, I love it too. I love Bibles. I said, I'm working on the biceps, but I got a Bible. He goes, oh, man, we love Bibles. And listen, it's always good when people like it. I didn't really pay quite close attention to everybody's facial expression on that. But it could have been that I might have walked past some people and they'd have been like, you understand? We stand out on Bible Baptist. Frankfort's pretty busy, that avenue. And we stand out there in the morning just waiting for visitors and people to come. And I wonder if some people are like, ugh. And then maybe some people are like, oh look, there's some Christians there. Hey, it's not always going to be popular. I think we're blessed to live in this neighborhood because there's nothing wrong with it here. Nobody's really upset about it being here. And so there's a temptation to conform, a temptation to conceal. But I want to talk to you about that coat and just give you, 13 points real quick. 13 points real quick. I want you to see it. Number one, the coat is about the Father. It's not about you. The coat's about the Father. That coat ain't about me, Miss Daisy. That coat is about God. That coat God gives me for the Christian walk is about the Lord. And God gave it to me. And, when someone gives you something and you can kind of, when you give away something to somebody, you can kind of judge their reaction. Maybe like, oh, thank you. That's nice. What else do I have? Or, wow. That's unbelievable. I'm so thankful for it. Hey, how are you about God's coat? It's about the Father. It's about Him. Romans 13:14 says, put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provisions for the flesh to fulfill the lust. Put on Jesus. The coat's about Him. Hey, when Joseph gets the coat, I'm sure the dad probably had a speech for him. He probably said, Joseph, I want you to know I love you, son. I love you. You're a son of my old age. I love you so much. I love your mama. Abraham had, four women having babies, maybe more. And back in those days, it was never right, first of all. It was permitted, but it was never right. Always wrecked people's lives. But matter of fact, David, all of them, man, when they started getting multiple wives, it always messed them up. Hey, son, I'm going to give you this coat, and Joseph, I want you to take good care of it. It's a sign of your dad's love, and, I think it's special, and I want you to know that every time you look at it, it's about me and how much I love you. Hey, when God saved you, gave you a robe of righteousness, and He loves you, and your salvation is not about you. It's about Him. It's a coat that we have to wear or get to wear, and it's all about Him. Number two, and I already said this, verse number three says, now, because he was the son of his old age, he made him a coat of many colors. He loved Joseph more than all of them. Hey, the coat represents the Father's love. Hey, when you got saved, it represents how much God loves you. He gave His life for you. He gave His Son for you. He didn't have to come get you. Now, young people, you mark this down now. And folks in this room that are older and have been around a little bit already know there is no peace and joy outside of a life with Christ. No way. Listen, bring them all to me. Pastor, let me bring somebody and show you how happy he is. And if he will be honest or she will be honest, I can pick that apart in 5 minutes and show you that they're not happy. They're not content and they don't have peace. The Father loved us so much that He gave us this coat, man. If we cover that coat up and if we get tempted to conform or tempted to conceal it, it represents the Father's love. God gave it to you. Number three. These are very simple points. I said 13 points are already on number three. Isn't that something? Jared, put Isaiah 61:10 up there. Real quick, I want you to look at this. The Bible says, I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for He hath clothed me with the garments of salvation. He hath covered me with the robe of righteousness as a bridegroom decketh himself with ornaments and as a bride adorneth herself with jewels. Listen to me. When me and Kara got married, I mean, I had a nice tuxedo. Brother Paul's one of my men and best men or whatever they were called, groomsmen. And Kara had a beautiful dress. Thank God her father paid for it. Praise the Lord. And when she came out, she was beautiful. I mean, they spent some time doing what they did to her and adorning her. Well, that was a good thing, right? When they adorn, that's about the adorning. Listen, as a bridegroom adorns and then the bride gets adorned. And so they worked on her. Jesse, I'm just telling you, it was ours, wasn't it? Wasn't it ours? They was in there for hours. I didn't see her all day. Hey, you know what I did? I got a haircut. I threw the tux on, and I thought, man, this looks good. It's perfect. And I'm thinking, man, I can't wait to see Kara. But I really wasn't thinking about what she was going to think about me, what I look like. But she was adorning herself as a bride for the bridegroom. And it was very important. That's the whole reason I'm saying this. It's very important to her. And God says, look, I'm going to clothe you with garments and with a robe of righteousness. Like you're getting married. And listen, he is the bridegroom. The church is the bride of Christ. We're the bride of Christ. And God saved us and gave us this coat. And it was because he loved us. It was from him. It was wonderful. And listen, we ought to realize, man, what we're wearing is special. Well, we don't have one of many religions. We don't have one of many gods. I'm telling you, there's false religions and false gods, and we have the real one. So you're just telling me that somehow I just happened to get the right one. No, I'm telling you that somehow God just chose you and saved you, and you responded to it, and you got the real deal according to the book. A Pentecostal would not like me in this book. Going into his church, because I'd be like, well, what does this mean? Well, what does this mean? Well, what does this mean? Well, why is this here? And they would get tired of it because there's too much controversy against false religions in this book. But there's no controversy at the Baptist doctrines we find in this book. And so I'm thankful the Lord saved me and gave me this coat. It's a controversial coat. Number four, the coat will give you dreams. Hey, when you get saved and you start walking with God, you Joseph dreamed dreams. When you get saved, start walking with God, you start get aspirations to do something different. I'm just looking at Miss Lisa, and Miss Lisa doesn't mind me saying this, but I'm telling you, when we met Lisa Cruz out here, what if it didn't happen like it happened, Miss Lisa? I mean, honestly, like I believe about myself, you'd probably be dead at this point. But she was so far down, and God came and touched her and put his hand upon her. And the same with anybody in this room. All they did that's different with this one here and Miss Lisa is he didn't have to go through any of that stuff. But God's grace, the same love, the same touch was upon him in that coat. And she gets the same coat as he gets. And then God loves them both equally. And it's not something that we should take for granted. And listen, Miss Lisa, I remember when she got her first job after we had, you know, taken care of that person or whatever, doing the home care. And then suddenly she's like, Pastor, I got a job being a bilingual secretary up there. What floor is that up there? 25th. The 25th floor, man. We go up to that office and look out there. Man, this is awesome. And boy, the what did that? Well, she started dreaming. Now, I'm not saying anything. Everybody in here has got the same thing. Same thing. Miss Jessica at the daycare. Nothing wrong with the daycare. But now working at the streets department, and people have a little bit of respect for her because she talks about the Lord. And just everybody, it's all different, man. We start getting dreams for our families. And Miss Jessica works her tail off to keep these four kids in a Christian school and keeps getting them to church. She's not perfect. No, but she had dreams that happened. And God started doing something. And you started wanting something. You didn't want to settle for the okey-doke anymore. You didn't want to settle for mediocrity. You wanted something in your life, and God gave you aspirations and dreams when you got the coat. That's what he does. And if you can wear that coat, so you get dreams. Number five, you'll be disliked. We've already talked about that. That code will make people not like you. Look at verse number 11. And his brothers envied him. Man, they were mad. They did not like him. They disliked him. Verse 4, look what it says. And when his brethren saw that the father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him. Hey, listen, if you ain't got some kind of pushback for being a Christian at some point, then you ain't wearing the coat. Just the way it is. So I've not had one problem with anybody ever, then you ain't talked to anybody about Christ. Because I've made a whole bunch of people mad, and I'm not talking about my attitude. I'm tomorrow on airplanes. Hey, I pastored a little church in Philadelphia. Why don't you take this card and read this? Got a good, I'm fine. Then I got to sit next to them for the next 3 hours while they're fine. I had a guy, I went to him, I was sitting in the middle seat, and I tried to give him a track, and he didn't want it. He was kind of a hippie fella, and he was older and just puny. And finally he turns to me and he goes, "Stop touching me." And I'm like, I'm in the middle. For some reason I get prayed up on that plane. I try to make sure I don't react. And I'm like, I'm in the middle, man. But it's really nothing. I can't go anywhere. He goes, "Don't touch me again." And I started thinking, I could right now put my hand over his mouth and push him down in this seat. And nobody would even miss him or know him, and they wouldn't even make any kind of commotion. And then I said, "Okay, I'm sorry, sir." And I'm thinking, why? Hey, you know what it was that made him mad? Not that I touched him, elbowed him. You don't get elbowed on an airplane. I'm telling you, there's just no way about it. If I sit on the window, on the aisle, I just try to sit over like this. If I sit on the window, I try to sit like this. But in the middle, you're stuck. And that me touching him didn't bother him. Me telling him about Christ in the beginning bothered him. I wish you could see all the, I've had people say, what do they say? They'll hail Satan. I mean, I get up and get that day on the plane. One guy says, "Hail Satan." And I'm like, "Oh, great." And he was somebody that I could just muzzle real quick and put him down. And Dale's like, "Well, we necessarily do nothing." We get off the plane, we see him come off, and I just laughed at him. I thought, man, but it's sad. Yeah. Because all I'm doing, and this is what I get up and say, hey, I just want everybody on the plane to know that I love the Lord Jesus Christ, and he's been real good to me. He came to me when I couldn't get to him, and he loves me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And if you don't know him, I can help you. And all this stuff that's going on in the world today, if you'll just trust Christ, it will leave. And if I can help you, let me know. And then it starts. Now, a lot of times, I mean, last time I came into Philadelphia, it was revival for some reason. They were just, everybody was happy. One time, this old white lady gets up, about 60 years old. She goes, "I just want everybody to know that I love Allah." And then she's like this old middle-aged white lady. I'm like, and Buddha. And she says all this. And I look at her. She's like standing where Miss Candy is. And then this old man, about 75 years old, looks at me and goes, "I like it." And I said, "I like it too." And I said, and that lady looked at me and I said, "Ma'am, isn't it great that we live in America and we can say whatever we believe in?" And that made her even madder. Hey, I'm not trying to stand up and make people mad. I am trying really to let someone know that I could talk to them. I've had people come to me walking down the runway and afterwards say, "Man, that was really good. I wish I had enough boldness to do that. I'm very thankful that you did that, sir." I have had people give me cards and say, "Listen, here's my business card. Call me and maybe we can work something out and try to help your ministry," and so many things. But then sometimes it's just wickedness. Hey, it's the controversial coat that does that. And I'm not, you know, a lot of you know me, you know I'm a straight shooter, but listen to me. When have you ever heard me burn somebody up that we didn't know or on visitation? I want people to see Christ in me. And listen, what I'm saying is this, is it's very important to wear that coat the right way. The coat will give you dreams. The coat will cause you to be disliked. Deep down, people will be jealous of that coat. That's what they are. They're really jealous of it. They want you to fail. They don't like that you have peace. They don't like that. They want to use this excuse. You think you're better than us. Man, how many of you in this room, we got to raise your hand. Someone has told you that you think you're better than they are. It's not true. That isn't what we're trying to do. The coat will make you not be light. He got a coat from his dad. At these point in times in Bible times, when a man loved a woman maybe more than the other women, and they were his handmaids, and she was the wife, it was nothing for him to love that child more. It was what happened. It wasn't like out of the ordinary for these men. They just hated him because the father liked him, loved him. Deep down, people be jealous of your coat. Number seven, the world wants to strip you of your coat. They want to strip you. Verse 23, look at it. And it came to pass when Joseph was coming to his brethren that they stripped Joseph out of his coat, the coat of many colors that was on him. Why did they, you know, they see him, they want to kill him, they want to put him in the pit, they want to destroy him. You would think that they would have just grabbed him and tied him up and threw him in, and then later on maybe took the coat off to dip it in blood. No, the Bible says when they seen him, the first thing they did is get that coat off of him because it reminded them of their father's love for him. And people want to strip you of it because they're jealous of it and they don't like it. And it's a coat, it's a controversial coat, man. God never said, listen to me, controversy should be something that, not that we go looking for, but we should see that in these times that we're living in. We've got bus kids telling people they have girlfriends and they're girls. And man, I'm telling you, that's sad. And then we've got some of our kids saying, no, that's not right. The Bible doesn't want us to do that. And then being yelled names at each other and different things. These are kids that are watching these talking points from the world and they're being indoctrinated. They're being indoctrinated. Our kids got no business being indoctrinated by the world's philosophies at all. It'd be confusing. We can only do so much here. When you keep them at those other places for much longer, they will not be able to fight it for very long. They're being told all that's all right. And even good Christians are believing it's all right. People that are saying they're saved. The world wants you to strip you of the coat. The world wants to stain your coat. They take that coat, put blood all over it, and stain it. How would they get us to stain our coats? By stepping down to do what they do. You understand, every time you decide to do what you're not supposed to do in front of your family that's not saved, you have stained your coat. It is not right to stain that coat. I've taken stands with all my family members through the years. Hey, I don't really want you to talk like that around my kids. Stop doing that, please. Hey, if we're going to eat dinner tonight, I can't have you drinking that beer at this table with me. I said, I'm nobody. I don't have to be here. That was my own brother. I don't have to be here, Rick, but if you're going to drink that, man, we've got to roll up out of here. And boy, those stands were tough stands. But you know what? They're trying. I can't have it stacked. Have somebody walk in the restaurant and see old Pastor Gates with somebody else drinking a margarita. He said, well, how is that? What's abstain from all appearance of evil? Man, I'm not for that. Alcohol ruins lives. There are young, independent, so-called Baptists right now trying to say it's okay to social drink all over social media, and they're idiots. And I would love literally to get my hands on some of them. And make them listen to me and let me show them why alcohol ruins lives, because I've seen it all through my family. And there is no success stories with alcohol. And so if they can stain your coat, if they can get you to go to work on a Sunday or to not be at church when you're supposed to be at church or to listen to something you shouldn't listen to, or be at a family get together where everybody's doing the wrong thing, but you're a Christian and it's your family, so you have to be there. No, you do not. Don't let them stay in your coat. Raise up, get out, separate. Jesus said, I came to put you at variance with your families. He didn't come to put you at peace with your family. He came to put a difference between you and the family. That's variance. That's the word he uses. And so that controversial coat, man, the world wants to stain it. Number nine, when you get the coat, there's a price you have to pay for it. I remember Miss Tania stood up giving testimony here and saying, everybody at daycare says she dresses like an old woman. Remember that? They all tell me I dress like an old woman. Now, I look at Tania Gonzalez and think she's one of the classiest ladies in our church, and I don't see old woman. Now maybe that's because I'm just a Baptist, and you know, but no, I think it's class. That's much better than the clothes that the world's saying we should wear. I mean, guys, listen to me. It's a shame you see an 11-year-old girl with shorts up her rear end walking down the street and with her mom and dad right there with them. And I'm thinking, what in the world? That's a stain. Christians, man, don't let them take your coat. Don't let them stain your coat. There is a price to pay when you start setting apart and doing right. People are going to say, hey, you know, why are you doing that? Why won't you come to the party? Why won't you be around this? Why don't you want us cussing? Why don't you want that on the TV? I walk my family into a house and they're cussing all over the TV. Man, that's a problem. I think I give that testimony in here about being down at my brother's house? Okay. Anyways. Just recently, and his wife had put a show on for us, and Kara thought she knew what show it was and agreed to it, and then all of a sudden things are happening on the TV that shouldn't we're not used to, but my brother's in the back in a bed and not doing well, and Kara goes, what are we going to do? And I said, well, the kids ain't here, and we're going to stay here, and we're just going to stick with it because this is a tough time right now, and it's not time for me to take a stand with her when her husband's in trouble. My brother, you need to pray for him, man. It's not going well. We're not going to take that stand today. But that's the only time I've never taken a stand, because a lot of times you got to take a stand. Hey, listen, we can't be here part of that. Years ago, when we used to have fellowships, we had Fellowship Sunday here, and we first started church, we left on a Sunday and went downtown because we were new to Philly, and we're like, man, this is awesome. Let's go eat. And we tried to go in Chili's, and they wouldn't give us a high chair. So I said, come on, we'll go to the Hard Rock Cafe. Let's go there. And I'd never really been into a Hard Rock Cafe, so I thought, this is fine. Let's go in. It's just guitars and stuff on the walls. We'll go in. We go in and sit down. Man, we're looking at the TVs. It's like, oh, rah, 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 rah. And Ozzy Osbourne's biting bats' heads off. And Kara's sitting there with our kids, and we ordered the food. And she's like, Burton, what are we going to do? I'm like, get the kids outside right now. I'm going to tell them to wrap the food up, and we're leaving. I mean, it plagued us, that place. Every time we passed for the last 13 years, we're like, there's the place where our lives went down the tube really quick, the Hard Rock Cafe. I mean, it was like, rah, 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 rah. I mean, my kids, when we see a movie or something, they start playing some like Hard Rock music or something, they're like, why do people listen to this? I mean, I can't figure that one out. But and then I tell them, well, when I was 12, I mean, I listened, that's what I listened to, son. And he's like, you did? I'm like, yeah, but my dad wasn't having it very long. My dad ripped it all off the walls, and when I was getting in trouble, and he literally, you kids think y'all had whoopings. And nobody had a whooping like I had a whooping. Belt slinging, bruises, and blood, and stuff like that. And yeah, I'm just telling you, hey, that I don't know why I'm telling you, but there's a price you got to pay, and you need to stick up for it. And you'll have to pay. After Joseph got the coat, his life was never the same. After he got that coat, man, he stood for right. Bible says God was with him. Joseph never stopped. Now listen to me, we're almost done, but I want you to listen to these last couple of verses here. Look at chapter number 39. The whole next 38 doesn't have anything to do with Joseph, but 39 we see he gets sold into Potiphar's house. An officer of Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh. And so after Joseph got the coat, his life was never the same. He stood for right all the time. Look at chapter number 39, verse 1. It says, and Joseph was brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him at the hands of the Ishmaelites, which had brought him down thither. And the Lord was with Joseph. And he was a prosperous man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. You say, well, how does the Lord bless that? Remember, it was all part of the plan. God's plan's coming true. Joseph has been sold and sold out by his brothers. For the dreams, God knew. And what they thought was evil, God meant it for good. We see that in, I believe, Genesis chapter number 50. And so the Bible says God was with Joseph. He's working for an Egyptian. he's having to be like the butler and the caretaker and all this stuff, and God is all over him. And so after he got the coat, he stood for right. His life was never the same. But after he got the coat, man, God's hand was upon him. Hey, listen, after you got saved and you submitted to the Lord, listen, I'm not talking about the day you got saved. There comes a point in everybody's life in this room, and maybe people in this room still need this point, where you decide, man, this is it. God is my everything, and it is not negotiable. I just listened to Brother Tony, a message Brother Tony preached, and he wrote that book, Some Things Are Non-Negotiable. And man, some things are non-negotiable. And when you get to the non-negotiable part where this is it, nothing's going to change your mind, man, then God is using you. God is doing something with you. Your life is never the same. God's hand is upon you. And Joseph wouldn't give in to anyone. Look at verse number 6. And he left all that he had in Joseph's hand, talking about the man he was under. And he knew not aught he had, save the bread which he did eat. And Joseph was a goodly person and well favored. And it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast her eyes upon Joseph, and she said, lie with me. Now listen to me. I'm going to be careful how I say this. He's a prisoner. He's a slave. But God's hand is upon him. And he takes a serious stand that he did not have to take. I'm just telling you. She said, lie with me. But he refused. And he said unto his master's wife, behold, my master woteth not what is with me in the house. Knoweth not what is with me in the house. And he hath committed all that he hath to my hand. There is none greater in this house than I. Neither hath he kept back anything from me but thee, because thou art his wife. Look what it says. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? He's talking about his master first. And it seems like he would have said, how can I sin against my master? He's done all this for me. No, he says, I can't sin against God. He wouldn't give in. Hey, listen, we can't give in. It's very important that we take stands. And there are going to be opportunities for you to sell out. And if you've done it already, stop it. Stop selling out. Wear that controversial coat. Make the hard decisions. Stop trying to be popular. Stop trying to fit in with everybody. Make the decision that God is everything for you. Number 12, and we're done here. What are you going to do now that you got the coat? And number 13, there are rewards for the coat. Joseph saved the world, literally. Zaphnapaneah, savior of the world. Fed the whole world. Came second in charge because he took a stand and God was with him. And tonight, listen, your stand is very, very important to everybody. Hey, that guy Kenny, he may never leave. I hope he does. But I'll say this, if I fall down, Kenny's got no chance. I shouldn't say it like that. If I quit, Kenny's chances lessen. And maybe there's other of us talking to him. I think that's great. We should all be talking to him. Hey, let's get out of here. Let's get you out of here. Let's get you out of here. Come on, come on, come on. What's stopping you? And listen to this. I'm not saying I am the hang all, that I'm the one that everything hinges upon, but I am a very important player in the church. And if I wreck my life, there's a chance that lots of you will wreck your life. Now you say, well, I'm not dependent upon you. That's fine. That's okay. But there will be some young people that will say, or maybe even my kids that say, he wasn't real. He wasn't real. And you know what? I'll never be the same. People get scarred for that kind of stuff and never make it out sometimes because of things like that. And the same would be if you fall out on me. You know, we had some tough times in 2020, didn't we, Miss Lisa? Miss Daisy? I mean, it was getting serious in life for a lot of us and for us. And I thought, man, this cannot be the end. And the Lord kind of blew in and touched everything. And listen to me, there are rewards for finishing. There are rewards that we stick together and stay with the coats and keep wearing the coats and not be ashamed of the coat. Everybody down on that 25th floor knows that lady loves the Lord, all of them. And they, a lot of them may have nothing, don't have nothing to do with God, but they know it. Well, years ago when we were filming that video, remember Brother Paul, I don't know if you're with me, went to Daisy's office across from City Hall. She got a window view. You still in that office? Right there, City Hall, man. It's an unbelievable view. We go in there. There's about 100 people in that room, maybe not that many, but a lot of partitions, offices. And she goes, everybody stand up. I want everybody here to know this is my pastor. Whatever he needs, I want you to do it for him. We're just filming a video. And I thought, man, that was awesome. You know, if the coat is too controversial for you, you know what you might do? Hey, just whatever you need. If someone says something, just tell them to talk to me. Just don't worry about it. Just be quiet. Make sure you don't bother anybody and let them see you, because I don't want anybody to know that you're up here. Hey, I'm not trying to lift them up. I'm just saying that's wearing the coat the right way. And it's awesome. And there have been many other stories with folks in here and us. That's my pastor. I mean, you know, the drug dealers. Hey, that's my pastor. I'm not your pastor. What are you talking about? You've never been to church. But pray for me. You know, I mean, and it's interesting when that happens. I'm like, but listen, they don't even have a coat. And they need a coat. And if we mess that up, man, we mess that up. And so tonight, let's make sure we're wearing the coat the right way. Let's make sure we bring honor to the coat. Make sure that we're set apart. Man, it's awesome to be a Christian. It's second level stuff. I mean, God has lifted us up out of the miry clay and set us on a rock. And we have something real. And our kids need to know that it's real. And we need to make it real to them and do all we can do to show them how good this life is, how wonderful it is. Every time a blessing comes, it wasn't me, it was God. It was awesome how God's done everything he's done. And so tonight, do you have the coat? Are you wearing the coat? Does anybody see the coat? I mean, you know, it's easy to blend in. It's easy to bend. But it takes courage to wear a coat that your Father gives you. And I hope that you'll do that. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you bless the invitation now. Help folks get to the altar. And thank you for the coat at least. And then maybe may reach some new heights and decide that they want to make sure that wherever they go, that people know what kind of coat they wear. That's so important, Lord, to this world, that they see Christians, not secret service Christians. And Lord, it's important to you because the coat's all about you. It's not about us. And Lord, when we wear it in that manner, realizing that this is your coat that you gave us, and we don't want to lay it down for anybody. We don't want to let it get stained by anybody. We don't want to be stripped of it by anybody. We want to take the stands that it makes us take. We want to bask in the glory of your love for giving it to us. Lord, I pray that you bless now. Help us to think about it in Jesus' name. Amen. Folks, you're at the altar. If you want to come, you come. Thank you. tonight in your house. Thank you for the love that we have for each other. Thank you because you made that possible, God. And how many people are so different can come into a place and be united like we are here at Liberty. I'm so thankful for that. Thankful for the friendships that we have made through the years, and new ones and old ones. Thank you, Lord, that you trusted us with your word and with your mission. God, help us to fulfill it. Help us to live in it. Help us to get back up when we fall. Help us to make sure we make no provisions for the flesh. And help us to put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, I pray for your hand to be upon us as we go. Give us safety. Protect the young people and others that are going to play a little basketball. Help us to get into that park and witness to anybody and everybody before we go home. Help us to be a blessing to somebody, to lead someone to Christ. Lord, help us as we, for folks that are sick. Brother Cordell, we continue to work on him. Thank you for getting him out of the ICU. Brother Blaze, for our family members and others that are struggling right now, God, I pray that you'd be with them. And then I pray for these that are doing well right now, Lord. We know that times come and get tough, and sometimes times come that are tough, but you're good and you're wonderful, and I pray that you'd help us. Be with us tonight, Lord. We love you. Thank you for the church. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the Spirit upon us. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, God bless you. Sure love you.